The agenda of today's presentation is we will, apart from understanding the basics about Agile, PMI, ACP, what all is needed for PMI ACP certification, we will undergo a use case, a case study. We will just look at a case study at how that Agile help in the implementation or help that project. Okay, to start with, okay, let's first quickly see what basically is PMI. So PMI is Project Management Institute. I'm sure you would have heard of this organization. It's a non-profit association which was established in 1969. It has over 5 lakh members and is now spread across 171 countries. So there are various certifications which are covered by PMI are CAPN, PMP, PGMP, PMI ACP, PMI Scheduling Professional, which is SP, PMI RP, PFMP. There is a new addition, which addition in this list, which is PMI PBA. This is again still in the pilot phase. You might have heard many people talking about it. It's associated with business analysis. Okay, so to broadly talk about PMI ACP certification, it came into picture somewhere in 2009. The pilot was executed in 2009, and till date, currently there are 5,000 PMI professionals. The last figure which is reported by PMI website is to somewhere around in 2013, which says it had approximately 2,900 ACP professionals across globe. Okay, so before we move ahead, let's try to understand how are PMP and ACP different. Any thoughts? Have you ever worked in Agile? I mean, before even I ask about the difference between a PMP and a PMI ACP, have you ever got a chance to work in Agile? If you, if one of you want to speak, do let me know. I'll just raise the hand. I'll unmute you. No? Okay. Anybody else? Okay, so so broadly, PMP is more around, you know, basic functional, basic fundamentals of project management, whereas Agile is more, ACP focuses more around the Agile way of dealing it, right? So PMP is a broader umbrella, but under that, Agile fits in as a project management stream with using only Agile. So PMP would also fit in to place as a, from a management perspective, even if you're not into a software industry. Okay, so Agile, you need, so if you have to decide, if a question comes that which certification do I need to do, PMP or ACP, the basic criteria that you should describe, you should think before, you know, thinking about or deciding about which certification to go for is, what line do you want to be in? Do you want to, if you want to, your main focus is a software industry and then you want to adopt Agile, go for ACP. But if you are not from a software industry, but still you want to learn with the basic fundas and tips and tricks of management, go for PMP. Okay, if even if you are into software industries and you want to learn project management on a very higher level or a very broad scale, then PMP is a PMP is a certification for you. Okay, now since I see most of you are new towards Agile, let's understand why Agile and why did we think traditional software development life methodology failed. Okay, somebody wants to add to it? Somebody wants to speak about it. Why do they think traditional waterfall model failed? For all the new joinees, in case if you want to speak, please raise your hand. I'll put you on, I'll unmute you. Okay, so let's first see why did a waterfall model fail, or why did the traditional framework fail. First and foremost thing that it failed was it was a top-down approach. The requirements at any point of a time could not change. The requirements were very static, right? So in case of at any point of a time we thought that this requirement needs to be changed, the only process to do that was we go back to the first requirement analysis phase and then come down. If we were somewhere around in the design phase, in the testing phase, already 2 to 3 months of effort was already spent, and changing the requirement meant wastage of those 2-3 months of effort and going back to the first phase. Secondly, it was a commanding and controlling style of leadership. In Agile, we say we don't command and control, we don't tell our teams to do something. Its teams are self-organized and they do work on their own. They have the prioritized list of items or features or the requirements they need to work on and the tasks they need to work on, and based on those priorities, they self-organize themselves, they pick up the task on their own. In most of the waterfall, most of the time that was being spent was on the documentation. So now the question comes, how many times one of you created a design document or a test strategy document, you went back and checked it? How many times did you refer it? You were in a testing phase, how many times did you go back and actually cross-verified what are the cross-platforms or maybe cross-browser requirements you have, or maybe the design requirements you had? They are just dumped in one in your configuration control system, and it's hardly a case where you go back and check. So Agile doesn't say that don't document, but the documentation in Agile is really limited. So you'd be using a sticky notes, and they would be really placed at a place which are visible to everyone. You would have information radiators. And the most important feature which Agile says is it doesn't have resistance towards change. If there is something you want to change, you inspect it, you analyze it, how this needs to be changed, you prioritize it, and you change it. Having said that, it doesn't mean that waterfall model has completely faded off. There are different projects where waterfall would fit and there where Agile would fit. So in case if there is a very small project and requirements are really static, go for a waterfall model. Agile would not fit in there because requirements are not going to change and it's a very small project. So in case if you have a project which is a long-term project and requirements would change, are very volatile and are very dynamic, go for a Agile methodology. Okay, any questions? Please, if you have questions, raise your hand. I'll put you on, I'll unmute you. Any questions? You can also use the chat window to type in any questions if you have. Okay, no questions. Probably we can also take the questions at the end of the session if any. Okay, now we understand a difference between a waterfall and Agile. So what do you think are the basic advantages of Agile? The first and the most important advantage is it is not resistant toward change, it responds towards change. So in any case, at any point of a time, if there is a change in requirement, it can be accommodated in your current scenario. Okay, so for example, if you're into you have your two, three iterations down the line, and if there is a change in a requirement, it doesn't mean that a customer has recommended a change and you will accept it then and there. So this change would go into the product backlog, which is a requirement document. Okay, so the requirement document or the SRS document, which we typically call in Agile, this is called as product backlog. So in case if you have a requirement which there is change, it would be the part of the product backlog. It would be prioritized by the stakeholders and the product owner. So the product owner is something which is similar to your BA. He is responsible for the and he owns the requirement document or the product backlog document. So it would be prioritized, and based on the priority set by the stakeholders and the product owner, it would be picked. And if it, in case it needs to be worked in the same same iteration, something of similar effort would be dropped off. So this is how it works. So Agile doesn't say that, okay, I'm ready to accommodate a change. Doesn't mean that your team stretches to a unlimited time and they're slogging in the office. So if you are accepting a change, would mean that you are dropping something of lower priority of similar effort. Agile focuses and Agile wants the teams to work on a constant pace. Okay, second is customer collaboration. In waterfall model, what happens is the client demos or maybe the final product to the client is only shown at the very last stage, if after all the development, testing, designing, all the UAT and everything is done. Whereas in Agile, client demos happens every 2 to 3 weeks. A typical iteration, which is of 3 weeks, would always end with the sprint review meeting. Sprint review, the client would be showcased the development which has happened, and based on the feedback, only you would move to the next sprint. There could be a chances that client doesn't like something, he would want to change. For example, if you created a UI, a login screen, client doesn't approve the UI which you have. So to change that, you would go back, take the approval from the client, reprioritize it, and probably you might have to work it on it on a next sprint. So customer collaboration, customer is continuously involved. Okay, individual interactions. So Agile says one of the principles of Agile is individual interaction. Rather than talking over emails or waiting for somebody to get back to you and creating the documents, Agile says go and talk to person face to face. Or in case if there are cross-located multiple location teams which are there, pick up the phone, have video conferencing. It saves time, and the level of understanding you would end up developing with such kind of interaction would be always high. Okay, so these are the basic three advantages which Agile gives you, but then knowledge of Agile doesn't mean that you are Agile and you are working in Agile. To be really Agile, there has to be a mindset shift which needs to come. Okay, so there is a question which says, who decides that Agile has to be followed, a customer or a project management team? So it has to come from both the ends. It cannot be just customer, it cannot be just the development team or the scrum team. It has to come from both the ends. Both the parties should agree that why they need towards Agile. They should see a long-term benefit from Agile. If the requirements are very static and the project is really short-term and you decide to be one of them, you decide to be Agile, you would never see the benefit of being Agile. So it has to come from both the parties. And they should really understand, and they should really know why they want to be Agile. They should know the need of being Agile. Okay, and then plus they should have a right kind of mindset to be Agile. If there are requirement changes, so in Agile typically we use the term called flipping the triangle, which says in waterfall model, the requirements are static and the time and schedule is variable. Whereas in Agile, we say requirements are dynamic and time and schedule keeps on changing. So if you are adding more to your requirements, time and cost would always change. That's why in Agile, fixed price doesn't work. Does that answer your question? Okay. Now we understand Agile. So you understand Agile. You have the mindset to be Agile. Why do you think somebody should go for PMI ACP? So PMI ACP, apart from PMI ACP, there are various certifications which are available in markets, like Scrum related certificates or certifications are there. One can choose to go for those certifications as well. But the major advantage which I see for PMI ACP is the PMI ACP is a larger umbrella. PMI ACP talks about all the principles which Agile would have. It will focus on lean part, it would focus on XP, Kanban, Scrum, DSDM, whereas other certifications like CSM and focus on only one part. They only focus on the Scrum part. So Agile is a bigger umbrella. So having, if you are doing ACP, you would understand all the methodologies which are involved in Agile, including Scrum, Lean, Kanban, XP, TDD, ATDD. Whereas on other certifications, you would be only focusing on the subsets of Agile. Either you would be learning about Scrum or you would be learning about Kanban, but you would not have the overall knowledge about it. Plus, it gives you a platform and a recognition that you are a certified professional and you would be able to fit into all Agile projects, and even if the teams are new, you would be able to coach and mentor them. Okay. Yes, Santosh, team PM. Agile does talk about resolving conflict. It also talks about coaching and mentoring. There are various tools and techniques. We will talk about them in the later part of the presentation. What are the domains which are there in Agile? So Agile, this certification starts from self-coaching to the team mentoring. So when I talk say self-coaching, it means how you can be Agile and how you can adopt Agile, how you can change your mindset to be Agile, and then how you can mentor and coach your team. And then the last part says how you improvise the current Agile processes. Okay. Any other questions? Okay, so I just mentioned that Agile is just not the about adopting it and having a knowledge. It's about the mindset as well. Now let's take an example. My team has adopted an Agile and I'm working on a requirement. So the requirement is, again, I'll take the classic example of creation of a login screen. I start doing it and I just deliver it. In between, if I'm not, and when I give the demo, I understand that this is what was needed. I would end up being mini waterfall. It would not be Agile. For me to be really Agile and to understand what exactly what's needed in the login screen, I need to interact and keep on asking questions. I need to really understand what goes into that particular requirement. So till the time I don't have that mindset to interact with my team, I cannot be Agile. If I'm not interacting, we will end up having a Agile failure and or maybe implementing a mini waterfall or different methodologies, right? Then Agile also talks about continuous deliveries. Agile says your code should be checked in every 8 hours. So before you end your day, there should be code check-in. Continuous integration should happen. And after that continuous integration is there, automated regression test cases should run to verify the code. So the benefit of doing this is if there is a bug, you would catch it at a very early level. So now I know there are two codes which have checked in. So I would always know that problem could be in these 20 lines which of code which has been checked in, because earlier my code was working fine. or the functionality was working fine. So for me, the analysis part would, or the debugging would only happen for those 20 lines of code. Had it been that I am checking the code or maybe integrating the code at a weekly basis, in week maybe I have written 10,000 lines of code, so the effort of debugging would increase. My team will have to analyze that 10,000 lines of code. So there should be a continuous delivery or maybe the continuous integration. Right? Motivated people, when we say having motivated people, we say this, since teams are self-organized, they own the work, there is a sense of trust and transparency that teams would know that what they need to do. The morale of the team is always high and hence they are motivated. We welcome change. If there is a change in a requirement, we welcome that, right? Incremental delivery, it means that we are not working in a big bang way. We choose the set of requirements which are adding most value to the customer and work on them in pieces, in chunks. We never pick up a requirement as a whole and start working on it. We break the requirement to the most granular level and then start working on those tasks. So the way it is, we have a user epic, then under that we detail that out and create user stories out of it, and user stories are further broken down to the task. To compare it with, a user story would be a creation of a login screen, right? And a task would be creation of a UI, creation of a test cases, execution of the test cases. So this is how I do. We work at a very task level, and this is where even the estimates happen. So depending upon the estimation technique you choose, the estimations can happen at the user story level and at the task level both. Okay, and learning through discovery, this means that we do inspect and adapt. We are refactoring ourselves as we move down the project. Right. So if anybody of you have worked in agile methodology, you would have seen that you have sprint retrospectives every iteration. So the idea of having a retrospection is that you understand and analyze or check what all processes. Master or agile coach, you take those action items and you work on them. This is called learning through discovery, and you adapt yourself according to those action items. Okay, and then there is continuous improvement, obviously, because when you are working at a very granular level and you are adding up to the piles of it, firstly you are working on the UI and then you add the field level validation, and probably then you are entering the login functionality. You are continuously, you are working in small slices and you are continuously improving it. Right, it is an incremental delivery. It can be both incremental and iterative. Okay, any questions before I go ahead? Okay, no? Okay, so now coming to the point which Santosh, you were asking. So Agile is, this PMI SAP certification is divided into 6 domain areas. The first domain which talks is about a value-driven delivery. So it talks about how you can add value to your customer, which includes the incremental development, the prioritization, and defining the positive value. We also talk about here that reduce the way. Do only something which is really needed and defer your decisions till the end of the time, till you have complete information around it. Okay, the second domain talks about stakeholder engagement. Since we are always talking about customer collaboration, so this domain talks of how you can involve your stakeholders, how you can make sure that their expectations are being met. Third is bolstering team performance and practices. Now, as we say, the teams have to be empowered, they need to be motivated, they need to collaborate, making sure that they're collaborating, they're talking, making sure the teams are really agile, they're empowered, their morale is always high. So this domain would focus on that. Next is adaptive planning. Now, once your agile framework is working properly, it's functioning as needed, there could be a change, there could be something you want to refactor, or maybe you want to you have some action items which are the things which are working fine but they can be improvised. For example, if I say I have a regression suite in place, right, as of now manual regression testing is being done. But going forward, since it is a manual effort is a time consuming effort, I want to change it to automation, and it would reduce my 75% of time. So that would be adaptive. Now I know my problem areas, I want to adapt and plan based on that. So this fourth domain would talk about inspect and adapt. Fifth domain is problem detection and resolution, which will talk about your conflict management, the problem areas in your team. Maybe the problem areas could be around three areas, which is like agile processes, individual interaction, and the fourth is overall system. So it will help you, it will give you guidance on how you can improvise on that. And the sixth domain is continuous improvement around product, processes and people. So these are the six domain areas around which the PMI ACP certification is divided. So the Santosh, Shanta, your question is how the cost and budget schedule is forecasted. So whenever you do an estimate, you do an estimate on the current set of requirements your team is gonna work. So every iteration estimates are provided based on the requirements that are being worked upon. So it is not the case that once you have estimated it once and you're working on those estimates only. So every iteration and fresh estimates are prepared based on the requirements that are being worked upon. In a way, you are estimating everything every 3 weeks. So because a typical iteration size is 3 weeks. Does that answer your question? Okay. So moving ahead, multiple levels of planning. So one of the basic myth which Agile faces is that there is no planning involved. Okay, but this is one of the biggest myths we have, because in Agile we have three levels of planning. The first level of planning is at a release planning, a second is at an iteration level, and a third is at a daily planning. So release planning is a set of features which you want to be released in one go. It could involve multiple iterations in it. Then comes as iteration planning, which is what all would be done in, what all features would be part of one iteration. And then at a daily level, what all tasks you would be, as a team, you would be delivering at a daily level. So if you look at this diagram, this diagram has smaller cuboids like which depict a particular features. Now based on the priority of these features or these cuboids, they would be picked and they would be the part of your iteration. Once you work on these iterations, cuboids in different iterations, they would be coupled together to form a final deliverable for that particular release. So Agile doesn't say that there is no planning needed. Agile involves multiple levels of planning, but these planning levels, yes, change with time. You inspect and adapt based on the planning. Okay. Okay. So let's before we go to the case study, do you have any questions? Uh, Santosh, no, the teams is it it's not mandatory for the teams to be co-located, but yes, for them to interact on a daily basis, there has to be a mechanism with where they are doing so, interacting on a daily basis. For example, you might have instant messaging server, you might, the teams might be interacting over communicators or Skype, or maybe they are able to do voice chat. It's not that the if they are diversely located, emails are, should not be the only way they are interacting with each other, or maybe they have a daily call set up. So it's not mandatory for teams to be co-located. No, not same time zone. You, I mean, I'm sure you would have seen there that meetings can be set up at a different time zones as well. Right. So for Agile to work, to have the individual interaction physical, it's not mandatory that the teams are located, co-located, and are working in the same time zone. There are ways you can make them interact, right? Calls can be set up, video interaction can be there, communicators can be there, or maybe you guys can work in a setup where there is some overlapping for the time. Right? Any other question? Okay, so now we are gonna discuss about a case study. It is about a company, a VOD company, which was founded in UK and Switzerland and was then acquired by a Fortune 500 company. So the product of this company was a application which could run video on demand or maybe live streams on various phones, TVs, and device, on various devices basically. So one of the basic problem this company faced was they had a very dynamic requirement. So for example, any time there was a change in any device or maybe configuration or a product, there had to be some changes which had to be made to their app. But the way this company was working was there were no formal emails, there was no formal communication which was happening the way previously this their VOD company was working. Everything was being communicated over Skype. There were no requirement documents. So whenever a client used to ping a change in requirement over Skype, developers used to develop it, and based on the information provided over Skype, testing team was testing them. So in a way, the two challenges which were here, there were no test cases written. Even if the test cases were written, since the requirement was changed, they were not updated. There were no proper documentation around the development effort as well. There were no coding standards which were being followed. So now when the Fortune 500 company acquired them, it became really tough for them to measure the progress and to understand what the actual product is doing, since they had no documentation in place. And this Fortune 500 company was a very process oriented company, but for them to understand the application, how they could what exactly this application could do, what is the platform, what is the framework on which this application has been built, there was no written documentation, and it became really tough for them to understand that application, because the end goal was to enhance that application and make it compatible to their more clientele. Now they could choose to follow the processes and change to waterfall, but the only reason they could not do was, one, the requirements were very dynamic. It was a long-term project, because making not only the idea was not only to make the existing product stable, but also to develop a new product with a better interface and more functionalities. Okay, so they had to move towards Agile, but now they had few challenges in adopting Agile as well. One, the higher management of the previous VOD company thought they were already Agile because their requirements were changing. They thought Agile means no documentation, so the documentation was not required. They were changing the requirement when they needed. They were communicating it to team and it was being done. One, so they were a little fussy about adopting Agile. Second, the current the vendor company, the software company which was implementing that and creating the application, were new towards Agile. They never knew what Agile was. The only way they were working since that project was incepted was communication over a Skype, and they were implementing it. Now there were many challenges to implement Agile, but the new company, the acquiring company, was really fussy that they wanted to have processes in place and make sure whatever is happening is being tracked. So as in future, whenever they plan to decide what new product needs to be created, they know what all went into creation of this particular product. So before even they decided to go towards Agile, they started to develop a team for that. They hired few Scrum Masters, right? They start to spend some time in creation of Agile knowledge in the teams. But the challenge was the higher management here. Okay, now when your higher management is not ready to be Agile, they are not ready to accept Agile, or maybe they are not ready to have documentation, but the documentation should be to that level that it is short and crisp, or maybe they are not ready to understand the importance of having prioritizing. They are not ready to accept why they should stop controlling and commanding their teams. What is that? What do you think you as a team or as a Scrum Master should do? What would be the approach for that? Any inputs? Okay, for such kind of a scenario, the best way to adopt any methodology is bottom up level. As a Scrum Master, where you might be spending most of your effort in preaching Agile, or maybe rather than you know, actually updating the information radiators, or maybe you know, reporting the correct status of the project, you would be spending more time. But then the best approach would be start with the bottom up approach. If your team is Agile, management would have no way of would have to accept it, right? They would be forced to be Agile. Right. So as Mayank mentioned, there should be open communication. So as a Scrum Master, I would say treat your team the way you want to be, they should treat you back. So if you want them to be Agile, start behaving like an Agile person. Be Agile. So if they want you to do something, ask them to document it. If there is a change in a requirement, add to the product backlog. Help, ask so many questions, probe your client to such a level that they answer that question and you are able to prioritize it on your behalf. So in few iterations, it could be an overburden for you. There could be so many additional actionable items for you. But with time, you would see that teams would start following it. Right. So to understand, to be agile, as I mentioned, start from the bottom approach, start developing a cross-functional team, keep giving them gyans of how to be agile, start ask them to interact with each other. So for example, now when you have team set up, you have cross-functional teams available with you. Now you have to estimate something. Rather than encouraging an individual estimation, get them into a conference room or a war room and make estimation as a team effort. Make everybody in the team available for that particular meeting and make them estimate that. Okay, so rather than telling them what needs to be done, give them a priority list to start with, that these are the few items that needs to be worked upon, and you can pick them on your own. Show that trust that whatever they will do, they might be wrong one or two times, but if you show that trust that yes, they can do, you have faith in them, you are empowering them, they would start doing it. Once the team starts seeing the benefits of being agile, the higher management would automatically start being agile. Right? So the solution, one of the basic solution which as a scrum master you should follow is, first is the bottom approach, third, make your teams agile, show the trust and faith and transparency. Plus, if when you have some kind of a support from your client, it would become very easy for you to implement that. For example, when you are getting the requirements, if you are one part of, even if the one person in your client side supports that idea of prioritization, it would be really easy for you to, you know, probe your existing client to so that, that you can also start prioritizing him. Though this is not a very acceptable way of you prioritizing on the behalf of product owner, but to start with, you might have to do that. But one thing that you need to make sure is, as a scrum master or as an agile coach, you cannot control them. You have to be the servant leader. Every decision that you take, you will have to make sure that your team is part of that decision. You will have to show that trust and faith in them. Okay? So as we say, you will have to show the trust and faith. You will have to have a strategy in place where you would say what are the tasks you would be doing, what are the steps you would take to coach them, to mentor them, what are the various action plans you have for yourself, and whenever a task is being done, if team is not updating, not tracking the progress of that task, do that on their behalf to start with. Keep your update the burn down charts or maybe the progress reports on their behalf, maintain them. Update the information radiators yourself. And with time, your team would start doing that. Right? So have a proper strategy and proper action plan in place so that your team can start follow it. To start with, you follow that plan and your teams would follow your footsteps. Okay, and then when we say have cross-functional teams in place, then identify your scrum master. You would be obviously the scrum master. Then identify the product owner. So the product owner would be the one who from the client side understands the requirement and supports the agile methodology. He understands what agile is and is ready to give your support. He has to be really a very strong person so that he can act as a gatekeeper for all the requirements. So the person who has been giving the changes through Skype would always come to the product owner this time. And if he can't act as a gatekeeper, there would be no way you can be agile. So he has to have that control on the requirements. Okay, no, this looks like a lesser priority on the as compared to the features or the requirements that are being worked upon. So this product owner has to be a very strong person. And then the scrum team, which would be a cross-functional team, this would involve all the maintenance guys, the testing team and the development team. And then a testing and the development team also should not have the Tom and Jerry kind of a relationship. They should start learn to you know, collaborate with each other and work together as a team. Start pair programming them. Clear? Any questions? Okay. So in Agile, when we say as I already explained, the requirements are broken down into tasks and user stories. They are broken down to a very granular level. Never work on a big bang way. Never pick up a requirement and work on it as it is. So if you have a requirement, make sure that you are breaking it down to such a level that you don't have more than 3 to 4 acceptance criteria against that requirement. So this is a general thumb rule which I preach, that if there is a requirement which has more than 4 to 5 acceptance criteria, revisit that requirement and break it down to a further granular level. If you have more than 5, there is something which can still be broken down. So work in tits and bits. Don't work in a big bang way. And then once you have the broken down requirements, broken down tasks, reprioritize them and pick up those priority items. Okay. So as I was just mentioning about a flipping a triangle theory of Agile, so Agile says that the time duration would be fixed, but the requirements would change, would be dynamic. So this is justified by having a fixed iterations, which usually they are 2 to 3 weeks, right? So once you would know that what is your team velocity or what is the strength of work that your team can pick up, you would always pick up that similar or maybe the some close average kind of a work around that. So in, obviously when you start with Agile methodology, you would not know at the beginning of the iteration. In the first iteration, it would always be on a guess basis. You would never know what is your velocity or what is your strength or what is the effort that of a work you can pick up. But once you go down 2-3 iterations, you would be able to understand that, okay, if in one of the first sprint, if I picked up a work of 20 velocity and in second I was able to do 18 velocity, then in third iteration, I would be able to do somewhere around 18 or 19. So plan your work based on your experience. And you cannot never increase the length of the iterations. Even in Agile, the meeting remains fixed. So if you have a daily Scrum meeting, which is only for 15 minutes, it has to be for 15 minutes. It's restricted. Similarly, your iterations, if you have decided them to be of 2 to 3 weeks, they will be 2 to 3 weeks. If something which could not be finished in that, leave that. That's a waste for your project. Clear? Okay, so this is something which we talked about, just to quickly go around the, through the slide. So release plan was optimized and the priorities were updated in collaboration with the client. So every time you add priorities to your requirements or you have a feature in the product backlog, this has to come from the product owner. So in this case your product owner was not ready to do so, probe your product owner and start doing it on his behalf to start with. And have the continuously improvise on your processes, because you would be having retrospectives at the end of the each iteration and you would know what are the things that you should start doing or you should stop doing, and based on that inputs from your team, optimize your project processes, refactor them. And same holds true for your code as well. Clear? So this is a typical chart that you would see. Since in our case study that we talked about, the visibility or the progress was just not known because there were no documentation, but after implementation of Agile, the visibility increased, the adaptability increased, the risk factor was less, because since at current moment you are just seeing the forcing the 2 to 3 weeks of iteration and the features you are working. So you always have a high visibility of risk. You are not bothered or concerned, at least for the first part of the iteration, that what comes into the next week, right? So the risk management is really good, because the visibility is only for the 2-3 weeks, not for the complete year, which is the case in the waterfall. And the business value, since you are delivering the value to your customer at the end of the each iteration, you are showcasing your customer what is being developed, the business value is always high. It's not that customer is just getting the documents, but he's getting to see the work which has been actually implemented at the end of the every iteration through sprint review meetings. So these are the this is the typical result that you would see if Agile is implemented properly. But the key is Agile has to be successfully implemented. Okay. So this is something we have talked about already, typical best scenarios where Agile agile framework could be implemented is something where we have a dynamic requirements and the project is really long term. Even these days in the construction based or in the real estate, you can see agile is being implemented. Where earlier were the days when you used to have the complete project was given to the people, or the possession of a project was given in big bang way. These days real estate companies work on one tower, they finalize that particular tower, make it available for people, and then they move to the next tower. It's rarely a case that they are working on multiple towers, and it's till all the towers are up and running or functioning, they don't release it to the people. So there are different processes or the projects, different kind of projects where you can use Agile. So the best way, example of picking up Agile is a long-term project where a requirement could change, right? Now, before we talk about PMI ACP, any questions you have on Agile? No? Okay. So Project Management Institute Agile Certified Professional Certification recommends 11 reference materials. I'll give you the list of those 11 books after we are done with the presentation. To appear into this certificate, you need 30 PDUs. 30 PDUs is nothing but the Professional Development Unit. For 1 hour of learning, for every 1 hour of learning, there is one PDU. So any 1 hour of webinar or maybe any training which you attend related to Agile will give you one PDU. So you can just go and claim those PDUs on PMI website, but there could be a case that PMI can ask for the proofs of that training. Okay, so you need 30 PDUs. It is valid for 3 years, and to renew it, you again need 30 PDUs. So it needs to be renewed every 3 years. Okay, as we talked about, there are three various domains and levels in which Agile certification is divided into. The first level is, the first part is Agile tools and techniques. So this part talks about how you can implement Agile, and 50% of questions comes from this. Then is Agile knowledge and skills, which is like your coaching, mentoring, how you can be agile yourself, how you can have stakeholder involvement, and then how you can mentor your team. This also involves the feedback cycles, how you can provide a feedback in the Agile method. Right, so the rest 50% of the exam is based out on this. So this is a segregation of these three levels. So level 1 would have 33%, level 2 would have 12%, and level 3 would have 5% of the questions. Okay. Agile, this ACP certification is broken down, so the into two parts. As I mentioned, the tools and techniques has 10 modules in it. First is the communication, second is planning, monitoring and adapting, third is agile estimations, fourth is agile analysis and design, fifth is product quality, then the soft skill negotiation, value based prioritization, risk management, metrics and value stream analysis. So this is all about how you add value to your customer, how you implement Agile, how you make sure that the quality of product you are delivering to your client is what actually they needed. It's always high, right? Then the PMI ACP exam pattern, there are 120 questions in multiple choice questions. There's no negative marking in these 120 questions. So out of these 120 questions, only 100 questions are markable, the scored questions. So it doesn't mean that the first 20 questions would always be non-scored questions. So PMI has this, that they choose those questions randomly, and any 20 questions throughout the those 120 questions can be the ones which are non-unscored. So one tip and trick which I'll give you want to mention here is PMI ACP has never negative questions. It never gives the negative questions. There are only positive scenarios which are there. You might see few negative questions in the mock tests or maybe in the sample questions, but they are just to improvise on the reading skills for the question, because they are little tricky. They might be the positive questions, but they're little tricky. Hence, generally in mock tests, we provide the negative questions so that you start developing the habit of reading the questions again and again. Clear? Now, to appear for the PMI ACP, you need to have 2,000 hours of project management, project experience. Okay, and 1,500 hours, which is approximately 8 months of agile experience. Plus 21 contact hours of agile training, which can be given to you by Agireka or any PMI REP. So the basic, whenever you apply for ACP certification, or maybe even if you have done for the PMP, there is a form you fill in, and you have to justify your 2,000 hours and 1,500 hours of experience. Right, so they will ask you about the project details in that form. So you'll have to give out the project project details, project manager's detail, and the contact details of each and every person you're mentioning. So you need to have 2,000 hours of project experience plus 1,500 hours of agile experience. This is must to appear for a PMI ACP certification. And then 21 contact hours, which can be given to you only by a PMI REP, somebody like Agireka. Okay, so now when you are applying for ACP, once you, as I mentioned, once you fill in that form goes to PMI. They review it. It's a 7 to 10 days of process. Initially, it used to take 7 to 10 days, but these days it's like 10 to 15 days. So in case if you have your form is through, form registration has been successful, you would receive an email and you can go and register for your exam. Make a fee payment and you can register for your exam. But there could be a chance that your form gets stuck in an audit. If it gets stuck in an audit, they would ask you to justify your project experiences or maybe your training experience. Your supervisor who was there in during that project for that particular project which you have mentioned, they would need a signed copy of it, and you will have to send that to the through courier to PMI US office, and once it gets approved, then you get a confirmation email, a success email, and then only you can register for the exam and make a payment. After registration of an exam, you can take the exam within 1 year. So for example, if you are registering yourself today, so you can give that exam till November 2015. You can take any date between that particular 1 year. So we have already discussed about which certification to go for, what is the best time when you can choose for PMP, and why do you need to choose PMP, and why do you need to choose PMI ACP. Just to reiterate for the people who joined a little late, in case if you want to stick to the software domain and you want to work in agile, go for PMI ACP. But if you are from non-IT industry and you want to learn basic fundamentals of project management, go for PMP. Even if you are from an IT industry and your aim is to learn the basic concepts of project management, but you are not focused more towards agile, go for PMP. Otherwise, if you are from an IT industry and you want to learn agile in specific, go for ACP. Okay? Okay, so this was all about the certification. So the fees for the certification is $495 for the non-members and $435 for the members. To become a member, there is fees, approximate fees of I guess $165 which you need to pay. And once you are the member of PMI, you have certain privileges that you get. You get PMBOK copy and you are invited for the free webinars which are there, which are organized by PMI. And you can again claim the PDUs from those PMI webinars. There are certain conferences for paid conferences which happen, and you are given huge discounts for those conferences. So in case if you are a member, you'll have to pay $435 for the exam. In addition, and this is not this doesn't include the training fees, the training which you need to do for 21 contact hours. This is exclusive of that training. And if you are a non-member, you have to pay $495. Okay. Any other question? Okay, in case if you have some questions later, you can write to support@edureka.co and we will respond to those questions. Once you exit that webinar, you would see a feedback form. Please do fill in that feedback form. That will help us improvise for our future webinars and classes. So if there is no question, I'll end this webinar. Okay, please fill in the form before you leave. Please do fill in the form, feedback form. Thank you so much. Thank you for your time.